Stay with me this morning as I ask the question, what is church? What is God's original intent for church? When we look at scripture, there are over 100 different types of descriptions or metaphors that allude to the church or talk about the church. The most common of these capture the words gathering or assembly. And the Hebrew word kohal, which means to gather or to assemble people. One of the first mentions of that is in Deuteronomy 4 verse 10, and it says, "The day you stood before me, the Lord your God, in Horeb, the Lord said to me, assemble the people before me, and I will let them hear my words, and they may learn to fear me all the days they live on the earth, and may instruct their children." That verse captures so much, but let me extract some of the things about church that's happening in that verse. We always look at the place of first mention when we look at a concept or word. And in this place of Deuteronomy 4, there is a gathering. People are called out. It's important to note that who calls people out is God, right? The gathering of church or the calling out or the assembly, it's called by God. The churches that are called by pastors and by bishops, we need to ask, is that church called by God? I believe that the importance of church is being revisited right now, and we have to ask the question, who is calling the church out? Right? And it's a very important question to ask. Has God called this church to assemble? And the assembly, it's not just a once-off. In Hebrews it says, do not neglect the gathering or the assembling of the saints. So it's not an Old Testament, just an Old Testament concept. It's eternal that there is a longing to gather, not just in our hearts, but in the heart of God. God is calling the church out, and it's calling together. If I were to title this message, I would title, "The Church Called Out." And God calls the people of God out together. In China, that has been under communism for many, many years, there are hundreds and thousands of churches. We call them the underground church. And I've had the privilege of meeting some of these leaders. There are millions of people who have met in underground churches for years. And their greatest desire is to meet or to gather. When I travel, the hunger in my heart is to meet with other believers. I am the happiest. I'm the loneliest when I'm stuck away in a room or in an hotel room and I don't meet or engage with any. But I'm the happiest when I come into the family of God. It's just something special. There is a DNA in all of us for gathering. There is a code in each believer to gather. The question I ask is, if there's no desire to gather within you, are you a child of God? It's a pressing question. Some of the other key points is, it says, I will allow them to hear my voice. God speaks throughout generations, but there's a time when only God can allow you to hear. You can be in the presence of a gathering, but only God will allow you to hear because He speaks what you need to hear. There is a word for you today, and that word might be different to what the other person next to you is going to get, or three spaces away from you. You might be at home. God has a word for you. I could speak for the next 40 minutes, but one word could change your life because God has allowed you to hear Him. And when we come, we need to allow God to speak. And we need to say, "Speak, Lord, your servant heareth. Speak, Lord." And Sam, let me not digress from my notes, otherwise and we'll be here until the tape runs out and the batteries go flat. The leader's role in this gathering is very clear. They are to gather the people before the Lord. The Lord calls the gathering, and then he puts the responsibility on the leaders to go and gather the people. And it's the responsibility of shepherds to shepherd or to gather. And we go and we gather the saints of God to hear what God has to say. It's quite simple. The purpose of church right here in First Mansion is a God calling his people out so that he can allow them to hear him. And it's the responsibility of the leaders to then go and gather those who God has called. Right? So we have got work to do. The response of the people, however, they must learn to and learn what? They need to learn to reverence God. It's in that text. Your responsibility as you hear the word of God, it's to learn. Learning is a process of not only getting information, but changing your behavior, changing how you live. You will know the tree by its fruit, and by this is your Father glorified that you bear much fruit. We need to live that which Father has spoken. And there's an incongruency, a mismatch in what we hear and what we do. And that is why we are constantly having to hear again and again and again and again. And I love it when people come and they say, "Pastor, do you have a word for me?" And the first word that comes to my mind is go. Get away. Because the word must come from the Lord. It's not a quick fix, buy and pay for a word. People must learn. As you sit here, you need to ask, "Father, what do I need to learn from what you are telling me so that I can go and change my behavior?" And we must learn to change and modify even who we are. Our identity shifts when we receive word. And that brings us to a place where we reverence God. When the word goes out and you hear God speaking, the first reaction of a child of God is we fall on our faces. We humble ourselves. Every reaction in Scripture, when God presented himself, the reaction was there was a humility and a bowing before God. A total surrender. And we need to come where we reverence God. And then one of the key things when we leave that presence of God, God instructs them that they might teach their children. I wonder how many pastors' homes their children are being taught. We teach the entire congregation. Well, we don't teach our children. The responsibility on those we hear is to go and teach our children, the next generation. Will you go and teach the next generation? It's our responsibility to reach the next generation. We talk about spiritual warfare so flippantly, and we quote Ephesians 6. And the girding up of the loins means to cover up that part of your body that's responsible for producing the next generation. And our spiritual warfare is a process of preparing and girding and protecting and teaching the next generation. The New Testament word, however, is, I love this, New Testament word. I'm watching the time, and I will probably have to cut short, but I want to give you some messages about church, because what I see right now in the light of Corona, the true church needs to rise up. The church of Jesus, it's in economics, is a process called economic or creative destruction. It's when destruction or catastrophe or danger comes in, or there's an economic meltdown, there is a process in economics that says, be creative to look for the opportunities to become stronger. And I think there is a creative destruction in Corona where the church is going to become stronger. Amen. We're going to find its real purpose, its true intent, but we need to go back to the mind of God and say, Father, what was your original intent for the church? So forgive me that the introduction lays a foundation for the church. And I might just have to park at the introduction. But as the pastor, and we've got live streaming, we can continue with an introduction or the body. In the New Testament, the word in the Greek is ekklesia, or ekklesia, as some would say. And it means, again, to assemble or to gather. The word is, when we say a Greek word, we need to understand the context there, because there are various contexts in which the word is used in the Bible, and that word is then colored, or the meaning is clearly defined through the context. So it's, so many pastors are quoting Greek and speaking Greek. Many of them are forgetting English. So when we quote a Greek word, we need to understand the context of that word. And there are various contexts in which the word ekklesia is used. And one of the contexts where this word is used, it's for gathering and being called out, but it means it's applied to when people within a town are called out to make a decision concerning the matters of that town. So it's a people that's called out to make a governing decision or a government decision. It's a group of people that are called out to rule over a town or to make a corporate decision concerning that town. The church is a body of people that are called out to rule, to govern, to make decisions. The reason why we are being made decisions for and being regulated is because we are unable to make decisions and to self-govern. And this process of being called out to rule is a very important process of ecclesia. We are prepared for rulership. You are in training for reigning, some pastors like to say. So you rule and reign with Christ, but you have to arrive at a place where you are called out. Many are still stuck in. The word also is used where soldiers have been called out for battle. It's a time of war, and the soldiers are summoned, or citizens are then called to become soldiers, and they are called out for battle. In this day, I want to call the church out and say, you are the ecclesia, and now you need to stand in the midst of darkness. In the midst of trial, the Lord is calling you out to stand. It's a time to be called out. And maybe through this message, you hear the word, God, you are calling me. You are calling me to stand out. You are calling me to come into this battle zone. And when the Lord calls you, He also protects you. He will never call you for what He has not prepared you for. So, I love another definition or context in which the word ecclesia is the last one I will use. It's a calling out of a people who don't fit in. It's a calling out of people who are different, or the word ecclesia could also mean to stand out. It's you don't fit in. You stick out like a sore thumb. And I like that definition because we are called out to be different. We stand out because we are different. We are the ecclesia or the church of Jesus Christ in a world that's gone crazy, in a world that has lost the plot. The church needs to stand up and say, this is the direction. Thus says the Lord, we are the children of God, and this is how you can get through. There comes a time in every storm that God raises a man in the storm. The disciples were on a boat in a storm, and God raised Jesus to walk on water. And there was a time when Jesus was sleeping on the boat. And I think Jesus was having a good sleep. And I'm sure his prayer before he went to sleep, because he knew things and he knew the storm was probably coming, he said, Lord, I pray that one of these disciples who have been with me now sometime will have got the point and they will stand up against the storm. But sadly, they relied that the master was in the boat. There comes a time when you are weak and you cannot stand against the storm, and you can go and intercede with the master. And he is a loving, loving master. He will wake up. He might rebuke you for your lack of faith, but that's okay. You will survive the storm. And Jesus says to the storm, be still. We need people in this day and age of 2020, where coronavirus has crept the whole world. We need people to stand up and say, we are the church, we love you, we will care for you, you will not starve to death, you will not die without me holding your hand, I will be there for you. We need a church that will rise up. We need a church that is loving. But all I see is a church that is hiding away. We need to get out and love our neighbors. And social distancing means that you can still contact your neighbor. You can still ask them, are you okay? If there's an elderly person that lives next to you, ask them, do you need anything? Because they are so afraid. They've been told, don't go to the shop. Don't go out. Stay in your home. The context of Africa is not America, it is not Australia, it is not China. We are in Africa. It's easy to say social isolation when we have 1.5 million people that live less than a meter from each other. It's easy to quote these things, but we have a crisis in Africa. And my prayer is that the church will rise up, because we don't have the luxury. I don't know about you, but I've been inside shacks. To tell people to stay home. Come on, we need to be realistic. Do you want to stay for 21 days in a tin can? We need to create... And the churches, we need to open our doors. We need to allow people. If we can't have gatherings of church services, maybe we need to create sterilized places where people can come and we can love them, we can feed them, because they're unable to find food. That day is coming. And we need to take our role seriously. My heart bleeds for Africa. You know, my prayer every minute of every day right now is, Father, draw a hedge over Africa, Lord, because we are not prepared for this virus. We are not prepared. We will see mass deaths. We will see entire communities wiped out If Corona hits like it hit in the rest of the world, we do not have the infrastructure, nor the resources, nor the social infrastructure to deal with it. And we need to pray for our government. We need to pray for our leaders. Church, if there's one prayer you need to pray, and we encourage in Scripture, is to pray for our leaders. It's now you need to pray for your pastors. You need to pray. You need to pray that when they walk into hospitals to pray for people who are dying, that they are immunized against this virus. And it's happened through centuries, through the Black Plague, the bubonic plague. Ministers have been immunized by the Holy Spirit. Now, don't be stupid and go and run in the traffic. Hear the word of the Lord and let Him speak to you. We need to rise up. Church, we need to rise up. It's our time as the church to be the church. We need to be called out. We need to be the ecclesia. We need to stand. I want to share a story that touched my heart. On Sunday, our brother Donat Chonda from DRC, I thought he was in Congo. He was actually in Cape Town. He was working, day of fast, and Sunday evening, he just felt his face and his arm go completely lame after his time of fasting. And they took him to hospital and they diagnosed him with a stroke. I was concerned, tried to send messages. I was corresponding with him via email, thinking he's in Congo because he had just told me 2 weeks ago he's going to DRC. And then he sent me some photos from the DRC, so I just assumed he's in DRC. And when he sent me that message, I know the conditions in the Congo. I was worried. I went into a time of prayer for him, and only to hear that he was still in Cape Town, I was so relieved. And they diagnosed him with a stroke. They couldn't understand why it had not collapsed. And why I tell you that story? Because yesterday, Brother Donat came to see me. This pastor from DRC, he while we were working here at church, preparing, he came in, and I could see his face was still a bit affected by the stroke. His hand never had the strength. He was walking with a little bit of difficulty. And I said, "Brother, how did you get here?" He said, no, I walked. I'm a soldier. I walked. I needed to see you. I need you to pray for me." And we sat down. I couldn't even offer him coffee because the electricity was out. And Brother Donat, I sat with him and I watched him share. And after we had prayed, I said, "Where are you off to now?" He said, no, Pastor, I got some." I said, can I, "You can't walk around like this." It took him more than a half an hour to walk here. He said, I will take you home." I offered to take him home. He said, "Let me take you home." He said, "No, I'm going to Grassy Park." I said, "You should be home. You should be resting." He said, "No, I can't rest right now." He said, "I need to go. There's a woman from Congo, a sister, whose husband has just died, and she's got 5 young children. I need to go, and I need to go and pray for her, and I need to go and comfort her." And he said, "Pastor, I need to give her something." I said, "What are you going to give her?" He's suffered a stroke. He's unable to work. He's got no income. He said, "Pastor, I drew 200 rand at the ATM before I came here. It's the last money I needed to give her. She needs it more." And he was going to walk from here to Grassy Park to go and take care of a widow, a young widow who had just lost her husband. And he wanted to go and take 200 rand because he was worried about her children that would be hungry. He had just suffered a stroke. I looked at this man and I said, Father, give me this kind of faith. And he asked me to pray for him. I said, I will take you to Grassy Park. He didn't know that before he had agreed to give a 200, I had put money in his account. Tenfold what he had decided in his head. God told me, put this money in his account. It was tenfold what he had decided in his heart to give to this woman. I want to tell you, church, our God is amazing. You need to hear. We need a church, an ecclesia that will hear from the Lord. And I want to ask you to rise up at this time. That you know, we are so self-conscious right now. We are so ready to preserve ourselves while the rest of the world goes to hell. While the rest of the world is suffering. The church is there to rule over decisions. And in ruling, we bring sanity where there is insanity. We bring calmness where there is a storm. And we bring peace where there is violence. And the church needs to rise up. We need to be called out. And Matthew, he's probably worried because of my notes. And I haven't even touched 10% of the notes. Matthew's controlling the series and he's been... We have covered the content. He has cataloged content for us for research and for homework. And we have done that, every person that has spoken. And can I have a few minutes of your time before you switch off, before you go? We need to be there for one another in this time. We need to be there, church. There are children. I had a mother say, Pastor, I am fearful that they're going to close schools for too long. It means I will lose my job. Who's going to look after my children? She's got three children. She says, who will look? I can't afford to put them in creches. The creches are even closed. She says, I need to go to work. My family is in the Eastern Cape. They can't take my kids. Who's, Pastor, who will look after my children? It's for some, it's fantastic. Yeah, no school, extended vacation. Some are so happy. No church. I can sit today and I can live stream or I can listen to the broadcast when I want to. Some will say, oh, fantastic, oh, finally. Some neighbors will say, oh, churches are closed. No more loud noise on a Sunday morning. We have peace. But we need a church that will sing the praises of our Lord. We need a preacher who will preach the word of the Lord. Unless they preach, how will they hear? We need an ecclesia who will rise up in the earth. And my question is, the Lord is speaking, and He's speaking to you, and you are the church. Amen. You are the church. It's this time for the church, and the church needs to be called out, and I'm calling out the church. In Revelation, there's a scripture. I don't like it very much. Revelation 18, verse 4 says, then I heard another voice from heaven say, come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins or receive any of her plagues. Come out of her. What do we need to come out of? We need to come out of Revelation 18, verse 2 says, he cried with a mighty voice, it has fallen. Babylon the Great has fallen. Babylon means confusion. And the systems of this world, it's called Babylon. It's Babylonian systems that prevail in our world today. And these systems control everything. And these systems, if you look at it closely, it is confusion. It is confusion. And I'm a systems practitioner. I believe in systems. I know every system of your body. I love systems. But there are systems of this world that is rooted in Babylon. I believe that God gives systems and God works through systems as well. But the systems of this world are rooted on three key principles and practices, and it's so clearly evident. And let me quote you the scripture. In 1 John 2, verse 15 and 17, do not love the world or the things that belong to the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything that belongs to the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of one's lifestyle, is not from the Father, but from the world. And the world with its lust is passing away. But the one who does the will of God remains forever. Oh, Lord Jesus. These are the systems of the world. It's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. One version says the pride of one's lifestyle. The world has had lots of pride in the lifestyle that is had. We have the most luxurious lifestyles ever before seen in history. It's shared over thousands and thousands of people who enjoy the cream of the crop of the earth's wealth, while a majority of the populations linger in poverty. And there's a desperate cry. And that gap of rich and poor is only so big before catastrophe happens. And what we are finding now is the earth crying and yearning for the revealing of God's sons. And the systems of this world, look at any system, you will find these things present. The lust of the flesh. Most of the money and the business over the world, throughout the world, has been over something called entertainment to tickle the flesh. Those systems right now, as I speak, are crumbling. Resorts are empty. Hotels are closing. Most of them are closed already. The people are going back to their holes. Things are crumbling. The fallout is not going to be a virus and people sneezing and coughing and having runny noses. The fallout is going to be an economic crisis that will hit in a few months' time. When we pick up the pieces of reckless behavior, we're going to sit with fragile systems that's going to cause panic and pandemonium. And I'm not speaking today to help you fight corona. I'm speaking to a church to rise up, to hedge and stop the catastrophe and the dangers that are looming in a few months' time. We need to act now. We need to become the people of God. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. I can spend a lot more time. But Jesus said, it is finished. Our struggle, even in church, is carnality. It's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. We have to, almost every counseling that I do is dealing with one of these three systems. When God comes in, He immediately addresses these systems through a righteous standard. And Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished." It is finished. If we take the words in the context that Jesus was speaking as a Hebrew man, it means the baffled wind is expired. That's "it is finished" means the baffled wind, that the wind, the beaten wind or this foul wind is now expired. It has blown its course. And what is Jesus talking about? He's talking about the carnal man. Jesus on the cross dealt with the carnality of mankind, with the soulish activity, and once and for all, He came to make it possible that we can live victoriously. He dealt with the baffled wind, the carnal man that's in all of us. Jesus made it possible that you can be victorious. The church needs to rise up in victory. It is finished. And that is John 19, verse 28 and 30. I love Revelation 21, verse 6 and 7. It says, "And He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give water as a gift to the thirsty from the spring of life. The victor will inherit these things, and I will be his people, and he will be my son.'" We're back to our original intent of God. This is it, that God is looking for a son, and He's not looking for a single person to be a son. He's looking for a corporate son in the earth. He's looking for a man to rise up, of which Jesus is the head. He says, "I am the head of the church." And both in Revelation and John, it says, "It is finished." It is finished. When we stand up and say it is finished, we draw the line. Why could Jesus say it is finished? Why could He deal with carnality? Because He faced every temptation that you faced. He faced every rejection that you faced. He faced diseases. He faced ridicule. He faced slander. He faced people trying to stone Him. He faced everything that you and I will face when it comes to the systems of this world. And He overcame. He did not sin. Jesus in the flesh, just like you and me. He was not the Christ walking on the earth. It was Jesus. And in the flesh, Jesus overcame sin. Oh, I wish I had time to dig into this. In the flesh. So just think, it needed a man who had baffled wind to come and conquer sin. Oh. God did not conquer sin on His own. He had to come in the flesh. He had to come like you and me. He had to put on fragile garments. And He had to taste temptation like you and me. But Jesus did not sin. Amen. Let me tell you, the power of the flesh who does not sin. When Jesus died, because His flesh did not sin, death came knocking. Death came looking. And death could not hold Him, because flesh and carnality only leads to death when it sins. But Jesus in His carnal body and His flesh did not sin. So when death came knocking, it could not hold Him. It could not hold Him. It had to let Him go, because He could not find any accusation against Jesus to cause Him to die. So death could not hold Him. And when he rose from that death, from that grave, he led captivity captive. That which captured us, he took captive. And you and I, as the church of Jesus Christ, we do not need to walk in the baffled wind state. We can walk in victory. We can walk in the love of God, and we can be free from the carnality that grips mankind. Oh, we need this kind of church. We need this kind of church. A victorious church. We need a victorious church. The church needs to rise up. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of a weak church. We need a mature son to rise up in the earth. It's called a corporate son, a corporate man, a body of Christ. And Jesus is the head. And if death could not hold him, it could not hold you. And these systems of this world will trap you and will trap me and will cause us to fall into sin. And then death can hold us. But Jesus came to pay the ransom so that we could be redeemed. It's a financial term, means he bought us back. So I want to draw to a close. Jesus is the head of the church. So the original intent of God for church is a man, a corporate man, a body. And in the New Testament, called ecclesia, it's people who are called out to become one. And in that oneness, Paul talks about, don't you know you are the body? We are a body. As you sit here, as we connect via different channels, the church needs to be a body. And a body without limbs, it's, I don't know what's the correct political word, it's physically challenged. The church right now is physically challenged, but a body without a head is a monster. and a head without a body is a monster. Jesus is the head of the church. We need to put him back. We need to reverence him. We need to come in here. We need to listen to the words of God. And we need to allow Jesus to take his place as headship in our lives and in our churches. When is head? The word head, it's an interesting word. It's the word kephale. So let me pause. Kephale is an important word to understand, because in over the years in theology, we have taught this head and we've confused it with rulership. The word kephale, the original, we trace different, again, context and meanings of the word. The word head means source, and it's the source of the river. There's a difference between a source of a river and an origin of a river. An origin of the river could start many kilometers below the surface of the ground, but the source is where the place where you find it on the earth. And the source is very important. Jesus is that place where you will find the church. It's the source. He is the source. And when Paul speaks about husbands, you are the head of your wife, he's not speaking about you are the boss of your wife. The word, it's the same word kephale, which means you are the source of your wife. So if your wife doesn't have love, it's because you're not the good source. If she lacks, it's because you are not the good source. So we need to understand this word source, because right now in this crisis that we are in as a world, Jesus is the kephale. He is the source of the church. He is the source. He's also commander in chief. We cannot be a monster without a head. We need to allow him to be back. And the church is built and established. God's church originally is established on word. God spoke everything into being. But with man, he breathed into man. It's the breath of God. The church is formed when the Spirit of God breathed life into it. That's what happened in Acts chapter 2. Without the breath, we're just going around on our own. And allow me to finish my notes. This church is called out. You are called out today. You are called out and you are built up upon something called revelation. And you need to have a revelation of who Jesus is at this time. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus asks his disciples, who do people say I am? And Peter gets a revelation. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the one. You're the head. You are the Christ. And Jesus says, Peter, upon this will I build my church. You are Peter the rock. What is Jesus saying? Many have said, oh, the church has been, and the theologians will argue vehemently about this, that the church is built upon Peter. We've made religion, we've made Peter a god. But the church is established upon revelation. It's a revelation of who Christ is. And we need to reveal who Christ is. This is the time. And that Jesus builds his church. I am so glad I came to understand that. That it's not the pastor who builds the church of Jesus Christ. Jesus says, I will build the church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Oh, Lord. You notice that hell has gates. It's an important point to note. Hell has gates. We enter through a gate. But the fact that gates will not prevail. No time. Leave it for your thought. We are called to be the church. And we need the saving work of grace through the activation of your faith. There are principles and doctrines that we are established upon as a church. The doctrine of salvation. We are transferred from one kingdom to another. The doctrines of baptism, and there are different types of baptism. The one we're in right now is called the baptism of suffering. Nobody likes it, but out of the suffering will produce a maturity. Baptism is an important thing, and Let me rather draw a line here and close with this point because there's lots of other points flowing. Let me finish. This corporate man needs to be obedient. God calls you to himself. The whole intention of church is to be a body where Christ lives in the body and the body lives in Christ. And he is the head. And baptism. Let me just show you the beauty of baptism. And baptism is an important practice in the Christian church. Have you ever wondered why we baptize? Why do we need to put people in water? These Christians are crazy. I mean, the guy just says, I want to accept Jesus. And he gets born again. And then We put him in cold water. Like, we don't even warm the water. We just put them in cold water. And we want to know why Christians are not hot. And why do we baptize? It's an important part of our doctrine. A lot of Christians don't understand it. Baptism is a statement we make to the world. It's a statement. It's a declaration. It's a statement you and I make to the entire, to the forces of darkness, the universe, our neighbors, our family. And this is the statement. And the statement is, and scripture says that we are buried with Christ. Right? So baptism is a burial. Have you ever buried somebody who's alive? This is my greatest fear, doing funerals. Like knock on the coffin, is this guy really dead? But you can't bury somebody who's alive. You need to bury somebody who's dead. Do you understand the process of baptism? You are making a statement, church, that I have died. This baffled wind, this carnal man has died. You're making a statement to Satan, the forces of darkness, that I have died. But why do we make that statement? There's a process in law that is a very important process. And Sam Solon and his teaching alludes to it. It's called corpus delicti. It means that corpus body, delicti, you cannot find it, it's missing, you cannot charge it. So it means corpus delicti, there's a missing body, so you cannot find the person guilty. You cannot imprison a dead person. You cannot accuse a dead person. You cannot jail a dead person. You cannot persecute a dead person. And when we are baptized, we are saying we are dead. We have died with Christ. We have been buried with Him. The old man is gone. It is nailed to the cross. So when somebody tries to persecute you, it's only the man that should have been buried that rises up. We have been buried with Christ. Baptism is a statement we make, and we come out of that water wet only to go and commit another sin. We make foolishness of these things, but we don't understand the power and the significance of these doctrines. And my time's up. The doctrines of baptism, it's a teaching all on its own. But beloved, we'll go deeper into the subject of original intent. God's original intent is for you to be mature. It's for you to rise up. And my closing text is Revelation 22, verse 17. And it says, both the Spirit and the bride say, come. Anyone who hears should say, come. And the one who is thirsty should come. Whoever desires should take the living water as a gift of life. And I encourage you, church, to take this time of total where you are practicing your social distancing to get close to Jesus. Dig into the Word. You'll have more time now to study. You'll have more time to be with your family, as you don't need to go to the malls. You don't need to go to these crazy places. You'll have more time to spend together. Can I encourage you to take the time? Be together, be family, study the Word of God together. We have some notes from this morning. We will make these videos available. The audios will also be available. The notes will be available. So there are notes here for those who do not have access to electronic media. You are welcome to come and get some notes, and you can study. There's a lot more in here that you can go over. Please take this time, be the church. We have learned for decades how to do church. Now we are being tested how to be the church. Hi there, thank you for tuning into our YouTube channel. I kindly ask that you click subscribe, press the bell, and look below for further information. We'll be broadcasting more next week. Thank you again for tuning in. This is a great time for us to start being the church instead of doing church. God bless you. See you soon.